State of the Unions tonight, and it's normal for the president to have some heroes in the balcony, the police officer who took out the sniper, then Nancy Pelosi will bring her hero, the cleaning lady who found a wallet with $1 million in it and returned it to its rightful owner, and Congress people are allowed to bring their heroes, and they get a little press. Here's who I would like to bring to the State of the Union today. If I were your congressman, I would bring the former superintendent of Elwood Community Schools. Her name is Casey Smitherman. She was the superintendent of Elwood Community Schools. She had to resign because she committed fraud. She was exposed, and she let everybody down. She was arrested. Yeah, she did something terrible. She really did. She had to hire an attorney. She was accused of official misconduct, identity deception, insurance fraud, insurance application fraud, and she resigned last Friday. She did something terrible. There was a kid, a 15-year-old student, was missing from school. He'd been missing for a while, so on January 9th, she went to his house. She saw that he had a sore throat, that he was sick, that he was all alone. He didn't have health insurance. So she took him to an emergency clinic, and the first clinic turned him down because the child was a minor and his guardian wasn't there. So she decided at another clinic to check him in using her own son's name and his insurance card, and she got a prescription for medications, which she grabbed at a pharmacy before taking him home. Police were contacted. The superintendent told police that in the past, she and her husband knew that this kid was broke. He came from a poor household, and they would often buy clothes for him and helped clean his house. And she kept it quiet because she was afraid the Department of Child Services would intervene and didn't want the kid placed in foster care. So when she went to check on him, Casey Smitherman went to check on the little boy, 15 years old. He had a sore throat, so she decided to get him some medicine, took him to a doctor, got him a prescription using her son's name, and now she has to resign because she's guilty of insurance fraud. This is the country we live in, where a woman who dedicated her entire professional career to helping children, to making sure they were safe, to paying for clothes for them if they came from broken homes, to her and her husband going to these broken homes and cleaning them, to then going to their homes to find out why they weren't showing up in school and then getting them medicine on a superintendent's salary, and then using her son's ID, his insurance ID, to help this kid get the medicine he needs. She gets charged with insurance fraud by Indianapolis police. What a country we live in. Insurance fraud. You know who's guilty of insurance fraud? Insurance companies. United Healthcare Group, fifth largest corporation in the Fortune 500. United Healthcare Group. They have revenue of $201 billion a year. That's $201 billion a year. Its stock, it's publicly traded, its stock close today at $268. 10 years ago, when Obama was just taking office, before Obamacare, United Healthcare Group, its stock sold for $27. It now sells for $268. We need Medicare for All. We need to put United Healthcare Group out of business. We know that United Healthcare Group is in the business of making profits off sick people. They're in the business of denying you healthcare because they want to keep their $201 billion. This wasn't always the case in America. The people who insured you weren't in the business of making exorbitant profits. This is a new thing. We have to put United Healthcare out of business. We have to put Cigna out of business. We have to put Aetna out of business. How are we going to do this? How are we going to fight somebody this evil? You know what they're going to do. The same thing the tobacco industry did. They're going to hire experts and tell you cigarettes don't cause cancer. If you're making $201 billion a year, United Healthcare alone, that's just United Healthcare. They're just one of the insurers. Don't forget the hospitals and the pharmaceutical companies who are also going to suffer from Medicare for All. If you're making $201 billion a year, how many millions are you going to spend to lobby Washington, to throw mud in the eyes of journalists and voters to convince them that Medicare for All is pie in the sky? We spent last year $3.5 trillion on health care in the United States. By 2026, Americans will spend $5.7 trillion on health care per year. We are spending $3.5 trillion on health care, and they have figured out how to privatize that. Wall Street has figured out how to get their hands on $3.5 trillion a year on health care. The American people know this. They know that they are being killed by United Healthcare, by Aetna, by Cigna, by our current healthcare system. We know this is unacceptable, that it's evil. So what United Healthcare Group does with their $201 billion is they hire lobbyists to convince Democrats that running on Medicare for All is not a popular, it is not a popular stance, that the American people won't go for it. And yet, Kaiser just put out a poll that shows 70% of Americans favor Medicare for All. It drops when they're asked, how are we going to pay for this? Because that's mud in your eye. Those are the lobbyists saying, how are you going to pay for this? Michael Bloomberg, the former mayor of New York, he's running for president as a Democrat. He was asked about Medicare for All. And he said, to replace the entire private system where companies provide health care for their employees would bankrupt us for a very long time. He doesn't back that up with anything, but he's Michael Bloomberg, and he's a billionaire, and he controls Bloomberg, which is the financial news gathering operation. Why would he support a government takeover of a $3.5 trillion a year industry? Why would he support that? He's the biggest promoter of Wall Street and corporate shenanigans. Of course he's going to be against Medicare for All. That would take $3.5 trillion out of Wall Street and return it to you, the taxpayer, the consumer. No, he supports employee-based health care, which means in order to get health care, you have two choices. You have to have a job or you go on Medicaid. What better way to keep your employees docile than by providing them health care? Of course, Wall Street supports employer-based health care. It turns employees, it turns your rank and file into slaves. I can't leave this job. It has benefits. I don't want to go on Medicaid. You will stay at a job you hate. You will put up with anything because your family depends on your benefits. Of course, Wall Street, of course, Michael Bloomberg would support employer-based health care because it turns you into malleable employees who will keep their mouths shut. You'll put up with anything to make sure your family gets health care, won't you? Do you know how rebellious employees would be if they didn't need their boss to stay alive? This is a rot that was about 40 years in the making. We are suffering from what I call generational rot. It starts in our 30s. Idealism gives way to being practical, to settling down, to taking a job, to getting married, having kids, and practicing the politics of what is feasible, not what is right. We no longer in this country care about what is right. We care about what is feasible except when we have to go to war. Then, you know, hey, mistakes are made. You got to go to war with the army you got, not the army you wish you had. Or when we decide on tax cuts for the wealthiest 1%. That's not feasible, but it's the right thing to do. We are taught what is feasible. Feasibility is manufactured by those who don't want to give up what they have. When it comes to Medicare for All, when your United Healthcare group and your revenue is $201 billion a year, you have to teach people what is feasible. You have to teach people that Medicare for All is pie in the sky, that the people who want Medicare for All are being childish. And only an adult recognizes that Medicare for All is too expensive. That's the script written by the healthcare industry. It's the script written by insurance lobbyists who stand to lose billions, trillions, $3.5 trillion, who stand to go out of business if Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All becomes law. The Intercept has uncovered documents. Lee Fang writes for The Intercept. We had him on the show a long time ago. He's a great investigative journalist. He and a cohort over at The Intercept uncovered documents showing just how terrified the health insurance industry is of Medicare for All. The article came out about 3 months ago. Lee says that over the summer, the leading pharmaceutical, insurance, and hospital lobbyists created Partnership for America's Healthcare Future. It's an alliance, a lobbying group of private health interests, and they're directing their attention towards Democrats to curb their enthusiasm for Medicare for All. It's an effort, according to The Intercept, to convince Democrats to walk away from Medicare for All and instead be reasonable, be an adult in the room. An adult fixes what is broken in our healthcare system and then builds on what is right about our healthcare system. We need to build on what is right with our healthcare system. And what is right with our healthcare system, according to these documents that Lee Fang found, what's right is the government is kept out of our healthcare system. We're relying on the free market. And isn't that great? We have to build on that because that's what it means to be a reasonable adult in the Democratic Party. To forego Medicare for All because why? Not because it's what's good for America, not because of what's right, but what's good for the pharmaceutical, insurance, and hospital lobbyists. That $3.5 trillion a year cottage industry. Now, 70% of Americans support Medicare for All, but they're going to get terrified by these lobbyists, by the Partnership for America's Healthcare Future. They're going to convince us to be terrified of Medicare for All. They're going to convince us that it's unreasonable and that, yes, there are problems with our healthcare system, but, you know, people who have healthcare don't want to give up their doctors and they're happy with their healthcare. Yeah, I'm happy with my healthcare if you polled me because the alternative, I know what the alternative is. But you know what? I have healthcare and it still sucks. But if you polled me, I'd probably say I'm happy with my healthcare if you polled me because if, you know, you're locked in a closet for 30 days and somebody hands you water after 30 days and then polls me about my water, I'd say, yeah, I'm pretty happy with my glass of water because I know what the alternative is. We're being killed by the health insurance lobbyists because there are profits to be made. It's like ExxonMobil, which knew back in the 50s it was destroying the planet. It knew it was destroying the planet. There are lawsuits now by states' attorneys generals that are revealing that ExxonMobil knew that they were turning up the dial and heating up the planet, but they kept it secret because they were reasonable. Let's not throw out an entire trillion-dollar industry like big oil. Let's build on what's working. We know that oil creates a little pollution, so let's build on what's working. Like, you know, fracking. That's good, right? Yeah, fracking is reasonable. That's what the adults in the room believe in. And then it turns out fracking is worse for the environment because fracking releases methane, and now we're discovering that methane is the worst of the greenhouse gases. Or Purdue Pharma. We're making trillions getting Americans addicted to opiates. But let's be adults in the room. Let's not prosecute the Sackler family for purposely hiring the McKinsey group for ideas on how to convince doctors to overprescribe OxyContin, as this Massachusetts state attorney general lawsuit is revealing. Let's not put the Sackler family behind bars. Let's be reasonable. Let's be adults. Let's understand that they were trying to relieve people of pain, and they're also given money now to research on addiction, and they're supporting all these private hospitals that help get people off opiates for a profit. Let's solve this using the free market. Let's build on what works. Cigarette companies, you know, that the tobacco industry still has lobbyists. Nobody in their right mind, although some people still say the jury is still out on the relationship between tobacco and cancer. You still can't get some congressmen to admit that tobacco causes cancer. But we know cigarette smoking causes cancer. But the adults in the room, the reasonable ones, say, do you want to put all those tobacco farmers out of business? Let's be reasonable. Let's let them grow the tobacco. Let's keep it away from kids. Let's ship it overseas to China, find new markets. But we can't outlaw tobacco in America. Let's just minimize the damages. That's what adults do. Build on what's good about the tobacco industry. It's unreasonable to outlaw cigarettes because that'll just create a black market. And prohibition taught us that outlawing something that people enjoy will just be good for the mafia. But we're the same people who believe in fighting war on drugs because drugs are bad. And fighting a war on drugs is good for the private prison industry. The lesson of prohibition applies to tobacco, but not to other addictions. And guns. Let's not outlaw guns. That's unreasonable. And let's not control guns, because the adults in the room know that it's ridiculous. You can't control guns. Then only outlaws will have guns. And we learned from prohibition that outlawing something that people want only makes it more desirable and makes it more profitable for the mafia, for underground sales. Let's be adults. Let's be rational. Yes, there are too many gun deaths. Let's come up with a free market solution to the problem of too many guns. The solution to too many guns is more guns. That's what an adult is trained to think. Why? Not because he's an adult, but because he's being manipulated by lobbyists paid to manufacture passive consent. And so when it comes to healthcare, Democrats, you and me, are being manipulated, lied to, convinced that the current system is fantastic. Better healthcare than anywhere in the world. We have people from all over the world coming to America to take advantage of all that our fantastic healthcare system has to offer. We're the envy of the world. We don't want what they have in Canada. We don't want what they have in Great Britain. We just need a few tweaks. But we know the truth. Enough people have talked to Canadians, Germans, Great Britain. They know what the rest of the world thinks of our healthcare system. Our system, our healthcare system, is a $3.5 trillion a year boondoggle. You know what a boondoggle is? A boondoggle is something you always associate with government. Rarely do we hear of a $3.5 trillion corporate boondoggle, but that's what our healthcare system is. But we only talk about boondoggles like Boston's Big Dig, because government is bad, right? There's graft in a government boondoggle like the Big Dig. But when corporations create a permanent boondoggle, it becomes an industry. It must be protected. A $3.5 trillion a year boondoggle. That's what the healthcare industry is. Corporate boondoggle with lots of overhead, lots of management costs. What does Medicare spend on management fees? Less than 1%. And so, according to The Intercept, this new partnership for America's healthcare future has hired lobbying firms filled with ex-Clinton and Obama staffers who are being paid to flood the Capitol, specifically Democrats, and convince them to reject Medicare for All and instead build on what's already working. And who better than Clinton and Obama staffers to tell us how to fix the healthcare system, given how much success Clinton and Obama had with HillaryCare and Obamacare? Yes, Obamacare was a start. It was a start, but there was no public option. He got permission from the pharmaceutical companies before he introduced Obamacare. He had to get permission from the insurance companies before he introduced Obamacare. The Intercept says that the partnership, these lobbyists, these Democratic lobbyists from the Clinton administration and the Obama administration, they're going to push the lie to Democrats that they can't win with Medicare for All, even though 70% of Americans want it. The Intercept says these lobbyists are selling Democrats on the lie that most Americans want a moderate approach to healthcare reform. The Intercept then points out that this new lobbying group, the Partnership for America's Healthcare Future, they point out that the partnership got to two senators running for re-election in 2018, Florida's Bill Nelson and Joe Donnelly of Indiana, two Democrats who were running for re-election in 2018. And they convinced both those senators, Democrats, that they should go easy on Medicare for All. And they did. And what happened? They lost. They lost. The Partnership for America's Healthcare Future, this is a Democratic lobbying organization paid for by United Healthcare, Aetna, they convinced the Democrats that you can't win running on Medicare for All. And guess what? Those two Democrats who took the bait, they lost. You know, there's a great piece in Common Dreams by Les Leopold. It's called Beware the Moderate Democrat. And one of the things he points out is that polling of Democrats reveals that of all the Democrats, only 3.8% of Democrats call themselves socially liberal but fiscal conservative. What that means is in the Democratic Party, only 3.8% of the Democratic Party is socially liberal and fiscally conservative. And yet the Democrats are convinced that we're a party of moderates who, you know, want to be very conservative. We want austerity. We want balanced budgets. No, the Democrats don't. They don't want to be fiscally conservative. Only 3.8% of Democrats want to be fiscally conservative. But with enough lobbyists behind you, you can convince Democratic senators, you can show them fake polling that says, no, the Democrats want to be aligned with Wall Street and they want austerity. Senator Donnelly of Indiana and Nelson of Florida lost because they went soft on Medicare. Because they were appealing to the 3.8% of the Democrats voting. You know, Florida voted to restore voting rights to ex-felons last year in the midterms. That's a big, bold, progressive idea that threatens the status quo. It threatens the core business model of the Republican Party. You don't want to give ex-felons the vote. But Florida voted for it because it was big, it was bold, and it was right. It was progressive. And it was right. It appealed to who the Democratic Party really is, not the 3.8% of the Democratic Party that wants to be fiscally conservative. 70% of Americans want Medicare for All. And so do a majority of Republicans now. If you're making $200 billion a year, the way United Healthcare does, you're going to spend money to convince politicians that those polls are fake news. Now, here's where I really get angry. According to Lee Fang's piece in The Intercept, they found a memo that reveals that this lobbying group is creating a speaker's bureau to get moderate Democrats out there speaking against Medicare for All. And one of the speakers will be Tom Daschle, the Democrat, the former Senate Majority Leader, who is now a health insurance lobbyist at the law firm Baker Donaldson. Senator Tom Daschle, who cornered Barack Obama and said, "You're going to be the next president." Tom Daschle made Barack Obama president when he was the majority leader of the Senate. He identified Barack Obama. He said, "You know, you're not going to be happy here in the Senate, but I think you're going to be our next president." And he gave him his chief of staff, gave Obama his chief of staff. Tom Daschle gave him his chief of staff to groom him to be the next president. This is Tom Daschle, Democrat, majority leader of the Senate, when they voted to give George W. Bush the war authorization to invade Iraq. Tom Daschle, who has a toupee, by the way, Tom Daschle could have stopped the invasion of Iraq in 2003, but in 2002, as Senate Majority Leader, he gave George W. Bush the war authorization. And then when he was defeated in 2004 by John Thune, Daschle cashed in and became a lobbyist. He became a lobbyist for United Healthcare. He was a lobbyist for United Healthcare when Barack Obama, his protege, was dreaming up Obamacare in 2009. The Nation reported on this. Who do you think was telling Barack Obama to go easy on the public option? Tom Daschle, the Democrat, Senate Majority Leader, who was getting money from United Healthcare. Remember Dick Gephardt? He was House Majority Leader from 1989 to 95, Minority Leader from 95 to 2003. Dick Gephardt spoke for the working man, big on labor, ran for president in the early aughts. He was big on labor. Well, he left the House, and now he's a lobbyist for Visa, Goldman Sachs, and you guessed it, United Healthcare. Mr. Labor, Dick Gephardt, is against Medicare for All. He and Tom Daschle were the ones who convinced Obama to tread softly, to take the public option off the table. The Democratic Party is rotten because they have been taken over by the adults in the room, the ones who decided, you know, it's time we got to settle down, raise a family in Georgetown, and that's expensive. Just give up everything you believe in and join the other team, but call yourself a Democrat. You get the best of both worlds if you're Tom Daschle or Dick Gephardt. You get to be corrupt, craven, bought and paid for by the healthcare industry, but you get to call yourself a Democrat. At least the GOP is honest about their dishonesty. See, the Republicans are hypocrites on social issues. Abortion, same-sex marriage, and drugs. Show me a Republican, and I'll show you a gay man hooked on cocaine who just paid for his boyfriend's abortion. They're hypocrites. They pay lip service, like Donald Trump, to the religious right. But when it comes to greed, no hypocrisy there. The Dems, no hypocrisy on the social issues. You know, if you're pro-gay, and who cares if you're a Democrat and you're gay or committing adultery or doing drugs. On economic issues, issues like Medicare for All, a livable wage, being pro-union, the Democrats, it's an entire party of hypocrites. 3.5% of Democrats call themselves fiscally conservative, 3.5%. And yet, all we seem to elect are the fiscally conservative, and they're hypocrites when it comes to economic issues. And that's the problem with the Democratic Party. I agree with the Democrats on social issues, but that's not good enough. Every time we focus on social issues in the Democratic Party, the Clinton and the Obama wing sees it as a license to steal from us. Hi, I'm Hillary. I'm for gay marriage. Now give me your wallet. And by the way, 10 years ago, Hillary wasn't for gay marriage, and neither was Obama. So they weren't even good on the social issues. Horrible on the social issues and the economic issues. That's what the Democratic Party, that's who runs the Democratic Party right now.
You're listening to the David Feldman Show, you happy, self-actualized hump.
Take a look at Bernie's plan for Medicare for All. As Howie Klein has pointed out, Bernie has been working on Medicare for All for 20 years, and he knows how to do it. And yes, mistakes are going to be made. I think of it as D-Day. We went to war against the Germans. We invaded Normandy. And Eisenhower said, look, we're going to lose a couple of thousand men, but this is the right thing to do. We're losing 50,000 people a year just because they don't have health insurance. If we make mistakes along the way towards Medicare for All, I'm willing to sacrifice 50,000 Americans a year if it means we eventually get to Medicare for All successfully. I'd rather lose 50,000 Americans a year fighting for Medicare for All, trying to make it work and fixing it along the way, as opposed to losing 50,000 Americans a year so that United Health Group can earn $200 billion a year. The government is already paying for more than half of America's health care bill. Your tax dollars pick up the tab for Medicaid, veterans benefits, Medicare. Don't forget CHIPS, the Children's Health Insurance Program. We're paying for a lot of health insurance. We're about 60% there. We can make it to 100% if you're willing to give Medicare for All a chance. And it's got to be better than the current system where $250 billion a year is spent just in administrative costs by the private health insurance industry. That's what recent studies have shown, that we pay out $250 billion a year just so private health insurance can act as an intermediary, coordinating between the doctors and the patients. That doesn't even factor in the lost productivity spent by doctors trying to get paid, by patients trying to get reimbursed. We spend twice as much as every other country does on healthcare, twice as much on pharmaceuticals. And yet, our mortality rate, people are living shorter, not longer lives in America. Studies show that people who have cancer and heart disease do better in countries like Denmark, France, Germany, England, Canada, where there is universal health insurance. Americans know this. As I said, 70% of us want Medicare for All. A vast majority of Democrats want Medicare for All. Republicans, a significant number of Republicans want Medicare for All. The only people who don't want Medicare for All are the members of the billionaire class and the people who profit off sickness. And then there are the apocalyptic Christians who think we're all going to die anyway, so why bother getting health care? The nihilists who make up a significant part of the Republican Party who don't want health care because they don't think it's worth it. And they certainly don't want to pay for my health care. Is that worth dignifying? Medicare for All, according to the leading experts, right now we spend $3.5 trillion a year on health care. Medicare for All, it would cost around $1.4 trillion a year. How would it be paid for? In Bernie's plan, $630 billion a year would be raised by a 6.2% premium paid by employers. They're no longer going to be providing health insurance to their employees. They don't have to pay premiums, which are far more expensive than $630 billion a year. The same way your employer pays into Social Security and Medicare, they would pay into your health care. And $630 billion a year is a lot less than the current system costs. We're talking about $1.4 trillion under Bernie's plan, $3.5 trillion with the status quo. So you get $630 billion by taxing employers. Then you get $210 billion from households paying 2.2% on any income over $29,000 a year. You would pay 2.2% of your income after $29,000 a year towards healthcare. I guarantee you ask anybody, any household that makes $29,000 a year or more, they're paying more than 2.2% of their gross on healthcare. $110 billion would come from a progressive income tax for Americans with yearly earnings over $250,000. $92 billion would come from taxing capital gains and dividends as though it was employment income, the way it used to be before it was changed under the George W. Bush tax cuts. When you sell your stock, you get dividends from your stock. It's not taxed as normal income. It's much lower. Bernie is saying that if you sell your IBM stock, the profits, the gain, should be taxed as income. And any dividends you get from IBM should be taxed as income. Under George W. Bush, they lowered the tax rate for capital gains and dividends. They'd get another $15 billion by revisiting tax deductions for Americans with yearly earnings over $250,000. They'd get $21 billion from a responsible estate tax that Bernie wants to implement, applied to the households of Americans inheriting more than $3.5 million. They're coming for me. You hear that? Right now, if you have an estate that I think it's like $11 million, all of that goes to your kids. Bernie and Elizabeth Warren are saying before $11 million, some of that should be taxed. And then $310 billion will be found just by bringing the cost of healthcare down, by making all these administrators who work for the health insurance firms and the lobbyists, by making them all obsolete, by putting these insurance companies out of business, you're going to save $310 billion just from that. Right now, it costs $3.5 trillion. Bernie's plan costs $1.4 trillion a year. That tax cut that we gave away last year, that was a $1.5 trillion giveaway to the wealthy. We have the money, but there are people who want to hold on to their profits. They figured out a way to make money off the sick and the dying. And they will say anything. They will throw as much mud in your eyes to scare you, confuse you, and tell you that Medicare for All is pie in the sky, that it's immature, it's childish, it can't be done. And yet, Medicare was done in the 60s, and the same people who are saying Medicare for All won't work are the same exact people who said Medicare would be a disaster. Ask your grandparents what they think of Medicare. They love it. It works. The government can do things right, especially when there's the moral imperative behind saving lives, because it's right to save lives, not because there's profit to be had saving lives. We've tested the for-profit model. For the past 40, 50 years, we've tested the for-profit model, and we're the laughing stock of Europe and Canada. Be very wary of any Democrat who tells you Medicare for All isn't feasible. Chances are they're accepting money from the very same turncoats like Tom Daschle and Dick Gephardt. It is one thing for Republicans to fight Medicare for All, because it is the job of Republicans to push for smaller government and to promote corporations. But for Democrats to do that, for Democrats to be against Medicare for All, if you're a Democrat like Tom Daschle and Dick Gephardt pushing Democratic lawmakers into not voting for Medicare for All? You haven't abandoned your party's founding principles. You've abandoned humanity, and you deserve to burn in hell. I don't say this about Republicans. If you don't want Medicare for All, if you honestly think corporations can administer health care more effectively, more efficiently than the government, that's fine, but go be a Republican. But if you call yourself a Democrat and you lie and tell Democratic lawmakers that you can't win calling for Medicare for All, you're evil. You are evil. You are like a priest who molests children. There's no difference, except you're killing more people. Tom Daschle should burn in hell for lobbying for United Healthcare. I'll wrap it up, but there are very few arguments that I can win. I don't like to argue, but I will argue for veganism, and I'll win that argument. You can't beat me on why being a vegan is morally and intellectually better than not being a vegan. And when anybody blames Ralph Nader for George W. Bush, I always say two words. Tom effing Daschle. Tom effing Daschle. Ralph Nader ran against George W. Bush and Al Gore because he knew that the Democrats were an unwholly owned subsidiary of Wall Street. That there was very little difference in 2000 between the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. And Tom Daschle, the Senate Majority Leader, Democrat, 2002, a year after 9/11, he could have stopped the invasion of Iraq by voting against the war authorization, but he didn't. That's not Ralph Nader's fault. That's the Democrats' fault. But the Democrats will always look for a bogeyman. It's never the Democratic Party's fault. Hillary lost because of Putin. No. Putin did meddle in our elections. Putin does use the Trump family to launder money. Trump should be impeached and be frog marched into Leavenworth for the rest of his life. But Hillary didn't lose because of Russian meddling. Hillary lost for the same exact reason Democratic Senator Nelson in Florida and Democratic Senator Donnelly in Indiana lost in 2018. They didn't push Medicare for All because they don't care. And the American people know that. That's why they lost. They lost because Hillary is cut from the same cloth as her husband and the same cloth as Tom Daschle. They're the well-educated Ivy Leaguers who believe we're all equal, but some of us are a little bit better, and that the Democratic Party isn't really about the working man, the forgotten man and woman. It's about success. It's about winning. All about winning. Bill Clinton taught us how to win. Yeah. I voted for Bill Clinton. And I voted for Obama. And I voted for Hillary. I voted for Bill Clinton. And when he won, I said, the Democrats prove that we can win again. And when Obama won, I said, we know how to win. We're the Democrats. We know how to win. And I voted for Hillary. I originally wanted Bernie, but I voted for Hillary in the general election. And I was happy with that choice because she knew how to win. Obama, Clinton, Hillary, they've ruined the Democratic Party. Winning is not the answer. A bearded Jew once said, for what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and suffer the loss of his soul? You want to beat Trump? Or do you want Medicare for All? I want Medicare for all. Don't let anybody tell you, don't let anybody tell you that it can't be done. Because the same people who are saying Medicare for all can't be done are the same people who said Medicare can't be done. That's how Ronald Reagan rose to power. His great speeches against Medicare. The same people who told you Medicare wouldn't work are the same people who told you Medicare for all wouldn't work. They're the same people who've spent the past 80 years trying to get rid of Social Security. Social Security has saved millions of lives. Medicare has lifted millions upon millions of senior citizens out of poverty. And to be against that, because you're opposed to big government, because you want a tax break, that either makes you a Republican, and I accept that, or it makes you something worse. It means you're a Democrat, but you oppose Social Security, Medicare for all, Medicaid. If you're a Democrat and you're against that, you're worse than a Republican. You're Satan. Tom Daschle, Dick Gephardt, who take money from United Healthcare, Democrats from the Clinton administration and the Obama administration, Democrats who use their White House credentials from the Obama administration and the Clinton administration to lobby Democratic lawmakers against Medicare for all. You are the devil. You, not the Republicans, you. You are the devil. You're the cancer within. You're the cancer within the Democratic Party. And we have to get rid of you. Because there are 100 million Americans out there waiting to find a party to vote for. There are 100 million Americans who don't vote. Because this Democratic Party is controlled by the 3.8% of the Democratic Party who call themselves socially liberal but fiscally conservative. If you're socially liberal and fiscally conservative, get out of the Democratic Party. You are a cancer and you are evil.